Today we'll be making the moon from scratch by simulating thousands of real meteors crashing into it. We'll also recreate everything from the frozen shell of Jupiter's Europa to the colorful surface of Callisto, and so much more. But let's start closer to home, with Earth's very own moon. Before simulating the craters, we need the basic surface of the moon, which we'll get by taking some noise, which is just a random smooth gradient from black to white, and applying it to a sphere. We then set the height of each point based on the value of the noise. White parts bulge out, while black bulge in. The surface is too smooth for now, but we can just add another layer of smaller noise, which adds detail and gives us a nice basic surface to work with. Now, the reason the moon is covered in craters and Earth isn't is because the Earth's atmosphere burns up the meteors before they can reach the ground. Well, most of them. The moon, on the other hand, has essentially no atmosphere, so all the meteorites stay intact until they reach the surface. The lack of weather on the moon also means that there is very little erosion, and thus the craters stay visible for billions of years. But wait, how does a crater form? When a meteor crashes into the ground, it creates a powerful shockwave which pushes the ground away, creating a hole which is up to 20 times larger than the meteor itself. Some of the ground is ejected into the sky, landing on the edge and creating the characteristic ridge of the crater. So, let's see that in action. We first create a circular hole in the ground, and then we add the ridges on the side. I also made it possible to change the depth, since most craters, especially older ones, are shallow due to dust gradually building up on the inside. The transitions are way too sharp, so I added three smoothing functions. The first one for the ridges, the second one for the floor, and finally the third one, which makes the terrain smoothly blend into the crater. And this one makes it all look really natural. But what happens when two craters overlap? Right now, the new impact just awkwardly blends with the old ridge, when instead it should essentially erase it. We can achieve that by pretending the first meteor never fell in the first place when blending, so its ridge just won't show up. Sebastian Laig made a great video explaining the more technical details of simulating moons like this, but I'm going to try and put my own twist into it. See, a sane person would just randomly dot these craters around the moon and call it a day. Or we can actually launch meteors, calculate the impact site, and spawn the craters there. Let's take the case where a large meteor already left a hole in the ground. If we were to randomly spawn the next crater, it would have an equal chance of appearing at any position. But in reality, it's a lot more likely to fall at the top, because it can reach its destination no matter what angle it's coming from. However, for the inside of the crater, some angles are blocked by the higher terrain. So, not all places have an equal chance of housing a crater, and we'll account for all that by actually launching the meteors.
We are going to spawn a meteor at a random point far away from the moon and shoot in a random direction. We can easily discard the meteors that miss the moon entirely, but for the ones that hit, how do we figure out the impact site?
Essentially, since the meteor follows an almost straight line and our moon is made out of points, the goal is to find the closest point to the first intersection of the line and the moon.
If the planet was a perfect sphere, this wouldn't be that hard. But because of the varied terrain due to noise, we will need to find a smarter approach.
We can do this by finding the closest point to the center of our meteor at every point in time and calculating the distance. If we can find the time where this distance is smaller than the meteor itself, we know there has been a collision. But how often should we do these calculations? If we check too much, we are doing a lot of redundant work and wasting a lot of processing power.
But if we don't check enough, we risk missing the collision point entirely. Luckily, we can guarantee to find the intersection in just a couple checks using this method. We take the distance to the closest point, and we move our meteor forward by that amount. We know for sure that we won't overshoot, since there is no other point that can be any closer. We repeat this a couple times until the distance is smaller than the radius of the meteor, and that's where we should spawn the crater. Here I've drawn out the paths of a bunch of meteors in white, and the blue dots are the points that the algorithm found. Everything seems to be working, so let's spawn our first meteor and wait for it to hit the moon. Once the dust settles, we can see that it has left behind the crater. Actually, spawning the meteors means that the craters appear naturally relative to the current terrain, just like they would in reality. And it certainly looks a lot cooler. I've also made it so that the size, shape, and depth of each crater realistically reflects the size and speed of the meteor that made it. I will now speed up the simulation until we have a nice moon full of craters. But there's so much more to the moon than these basic craters, and we'll simulate these darker areas next. They're called maria, Latin for seas, and they formed a few billion years later than the moon itself when a set of gigantic meteorites struck the moon, leaving behind deep basins. The complexity of the moon's surface just keeps getting more and more fascinating, and I had to see it with my own eyes. So I actually went outside, set up my telescope, and took a look for myself. One thing I immediately noticed is that the seas have far fewer craters than the highlands. But why is that? The deep basins were eventually filled with lava, and when it cooled off, it left behind a fresh layer of crust, essentially erasing all the history of the terrain. Only the craters that formed after the surface cooled down are still visible.
To simulate the seas, we'll take a particularly large meteor and choose the points close to its landing site to represent our sea, and then smoothen out the transition a bit. We then add some noise to make the shape more natural, and then we just increase the number of meteors until we have some natural-looking seas.
We can now lower the terrain to get a deep basin, and I also made it rise up a bit on the transition to mimic these mountains that often appear at the edge of a sea. I also made it so that I can modify the colors, so let's take that to something slightly more realistic. All that's left to do is change the age of the seas. For example, if the seas are relatively young, all the older craters are erased. Now, in reality, all of the seas face towards the Earth, since the moon is tidally locked to it. But I'll simulate more advanced systems like these in a future video of this new series, where we'll be building up to simulating an entire galaxy. So subscribe so you don't miss out on that. But don't worry, I'll still be simulating many other moons from our solar system in this video.
I just have to make a few small improvements first to really take the realism of our moon to the next level.
Let's start with improving the craters. Firstly, even though there is no weather, there is still some erosion, so the craters should gradually blend into the terrain as they get older. Also, most craters aren't perfect circles, so we can add some noise to the shape of the crater. Since we are no longer limited to the circular craters, we can simulate some other interesting cases. For example, if the angle of impact is very small, the meteor will slide across the surface and leave an elongated crater like this. We can also simulate a dual crater, which occurs when binary asteroids crash into the moon at the same time, leaving neither of the craters with a dominant ridge. A really interesting case that sometimes occurs with larger craters is this mountain that forms in the middle. Same as when you throw a rock into a puddle, some of the material shoots straight up, and when it lands back down, it forms this central peak. Finally, for perhaps the most beautiful crater type, we have these younger craters that leave behind colorful spikes called ejecta rays, consisting of the ejected material. I simulated this by adding a smooth color drop-off and distorting it, you guessed it, using noise. This already looks cool, but it's missing these super long rays, so we'll add another far larger drop-off, and the noise for it will be far more powerful to create isolated long rays. Now we just blend this into the surroundings to finish off the ejecta rays. Now that we have a nice variety of craters, we have to improve the graphics, and we'll start by fixing these lines at the edge between two chunks. These occur because normals, which determine the shadows, are calculated for each point by averaging the slope of its neighboring triangles. But when these triangles belong to separate chunks, the same point ends up calculating two different values, which leads to the seams. So we have to send the data of the triangles to the neighboring chunk, and that gets rid of the seams.
So here are the old seams, and this is how it looks now. A lot better.
Now we can crank up the resolution and number of craters. But the colors still look a bit off. So after fixing that, let's see what our final moon looks like. If I do say so myself, it actually turned out pretty close to the real thing. The only thing is that this super high resolution version with 8,000 craters took about 10 minutes to generate, so there's a lot of optimization to be done for future versions. But our moon is far from the only one. There's hundreds just in our solar system. So I made a Patreon poll asking which ones you'd like to see me simulate, and the first winner was Callisto, which orbits Jupiter. In many ways, it is similar to our moon, but it doesn't have the visible maria. Instead, the ejecta is far more prominent. But perhaps the most recognizable part is the rainbow-like surface, which I will blend in with some darker tones. This is looking super interesting, and the dark side perhaps looks even better, kind of like the night sky. After playing around with the colors for a while, I got something that looks pretty close to this picture. The sad reality is that it was taken by a satellite that works far differently than our own eyes, so if you actually looked at Callisto, it would probably look more like this, but I still wanted to simulate the more saturated version since it just looks more unique. By the way, if you'd like to be part of polls like this and get other benefits like seeing the videos early and behind the scenes extras, check out the Patreon link in the description. The other poll winner was Europa. No, not that one, the one orbiting Jupiter. It's one of the most unique moons in our solar system, and the biggest difference from our own moon is that there are almost no craters. Its surface is a combination of red and blue, with the red part skewed more towards the equator. But here's the interesting part, it is actually not made out of rocks, but instead a 10 km deep layer of ice under which lays an ocean, which scientists believe could house life. And these red lines across the surface are actually cracks in the ice, which I will simulate by spawning some straight lines along the surface and then adding some randomness to their direction. These aren't really cracks at the moment, so I will make them carve into the ground similarly to what I did with the rivers in the last video. I will just spawn a whole lot of craters close to each other until the surface is smooth. And here is the final Europa. Using the tools I developed in this video, we can recreate many of the other simpler moons in our solar system, like Mars's Phobos, which is only 11 kilometers across. Here is Saturn's Hyperion with its elongated shape and sharp craters. And finally Iapetus, the yin-yang moon. And here are some other interesting moons I came up with by playing around with the settings. I really like this one, I call it the Eye. Eventually we'll randomize these parameters and pair the moons with planets to create random solar systems. However, more complex moons like Io and Titan would require developing more intricate tools, so leave your suggestions in the comment section if you'd like to see me tackle them in the future. I wanted to finish this video off by going back to the Earth's moon and putting it into orbit around the planet for my random planet generator series. So let's wait for the sun to set and find the moon. It's obviously a bit bigger than in reality, but the craters and details look really nice from here. We can even cycle through the different phases of the moon, all the way from a young moon to the beautiful full moon. But we aren't here to explore the Earth's surface, so I think it's finally time to take one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind. I'm really happy with how varied the surface turned out to be. There's everything from old, faint craters to younger and smaller ones. The moon has always fascinated me, and when I was a kid it was my dream to one day walk on its surface. So I'd like to thank all of you, and especially my Patreons, for making videos like this possible. I've uploaded this project on my Patreon if you want to play around with the settings and generate some beautiful moons, but in a couple of weeks I'll be releasing it to everyone, so stay tuned for that. If you're new here, just a like and a subscribe would also really help, and you can join the Discord to chat about moons and planets together. The next video of the Earth-like planet generation series is already in the works, but until then you can click here to catch up on the series if you haven't seen it already.